I want to go on record by saying I like that jacket.
Amen. Amen. What great singing and what great preaching tonight. Thank God for it. Brother Michael, thank you. I love this brother. I just met him this week, first time we've ever been together, and I thank God for him. He preaches like he believes what he's saying, doesn't he? Amen. I like it. Brother Jerry christened us the M&M Brothers. If we do many of these conferences together, we might make some t-shirts. That's a marketable product, don't you think? Amen. Philippians chapter 3, if you have your copy of the Bible in hand, and I'm trusting you do, since we're in a Bible conference, it helps to have the right tools for the trade, doesn't it? The right tools for the job. I am astonished that I have never noticed before that the daughter was 12 and the disease was 12 years old. You know, you say, well, idiot, read the Bible. There it is in black and white. And that's the thing about the Bible. I started reading through the scriptures in a systematic way in my teens. And I'm 54. I'll be 55 in just a few weeks. I'm the same age as Mildale. Mildale started in 63. I started in 63. I know I look older than that. All I can do is say I'm sorry. I'll show you some documentation to prove that that's when I was born. And I don't remember what I was going. Where was I going with that? I get my age bothers me so bad. I got my first offer of a senior citizen discount when I was 42 years old in Duncan, Oklahoma. I can take you to the spot. It scarred me forever. It bothers me so much. But I've been thank you. I started reading through the Bible in a regular way, in a systematic way, when I was 17 years old. And I've been doing that now all these years. But the thing about this book is it's not like any other book. You can't learn this as if it were a textbook on history or geography. Every time I read it, there's something I swear wasn't there the last time I read through the Bible. I swear, how did that get in there and I didn't see it before? That divine coincidence, wasn't that remarkable? It blessed my heart tonight. Well, Philippians 3:14, do you have room in your soul for one more sliver of truth? I want to just take a bite-sized morsel from the Word of God tonight and to wallow around in it for a few minutes with you. Philippians 3:14, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Now, this text comes in the context of the most precious passage in the whole Bible to me. I consider Philippians chapter 3 to be the Mount Everest of the Christian life. It is the confession, the personal testimony of perhaps the most sold out disciple of Jesus to ever live. The Apostle Paul spelled out in plain language what made him tick, what drove him. The essence of his spiritual motivation is summed up in Philippians chapter 3. I've written many messages on this passage through the years of my Christianity, the years of my call to preach. I started writing from verse 1 down to verse 16, taking the whole section, and then I knew I couldn't be satisfied with that. And so through the years, I've gone back and I've taken piece by piece this entire paragraph and preached on a little bit here and a little bit there. And now tonight, for the first time in my life and my ministry, I'm going to preach on this 14th verse alone. I want to isolate it in your thinking tonight because, and this is what's drawn me to it. This is my first time ever to preach this passage as I'm preaching it tonight. And what drew me in is the fierceness of its focus, the concentrated intensity of the Apostle Paul. Wrapped up in this great statement, this Holy Ghost-inspired sentence. I want to look at it with you tonight, a phrase at a time. And the clauses of this verse naturally fall into five divisions. I may not preach all five of them. We'll see how the Lord gives utterance. But I do at least want to get started by looking at the first two words of the text. I call it a determined activity. Paul said, I press. I press. The verb is intense. Used originally, it spoke of a hunter who was stalking a prey. It spoke of someone who was tracking his quarry. It was a word that came to be used of persecution. In fact, in some context, it's used like that, even in the scripture, of someone being hounded by an enemy, of persecution. It then moved into the realm by the time of the writing of the New Testament. It had morphed into a word that was used in the world of athletics. It was a word that was used in the track and field world of runners who were racing toward a finish line. Couldn't help but think of it tonight as Brother Michael illustrated the desperation of that woman lunging toward Jesus. You've all seen runners who were so desperate to cross the tape to win the prize that they would thrust themselves forward to break the tape. Now, that's something I have to just watch from the sidelines. You can look at me and see I'm not built for the race. You'd have to talk to Brother Larry Jordan about that. He's the runner. He's the man who was the great the track athlete in high school and college. And we were in a meeting together just not long ago, Brother Larry and I, and the church took up offerings each night in the little baskets with handles on them. And they would pass those baskets down the row, and a good friend of mine sat beside me all week, and I would pass it. You know, it was for me, so I didn't put anything in it. I just passed the bucket on to him, and I fumbled it every night. I fumbled around trying to handle it. He said, all week long, every service this week, are you ever going to learn how to hand that off right? And I said, man, you can look at me and see I don't know what to do with a baton. I don't know the hand. Give me a shot put, and I might do something with it, but I can't hand off a baton. But you know what this is about. You've seen it happen. The runner who pushes himself to the limit of his ability, who thrusts himself forward. The word in this text can be defined to run after something with passion, to earnestly endeavor to acquire a thing. In other words, there's nothing lukewarm or apathetic about this man of God. He was marked by a burning and a yearning. There was a hunger in his heart to press on in the Lord, to grow up in Christ. This verb is in the active voice. I press. Meaning Paul wasn't lounging around spiritually. He wasn't twiddling his thumbs. He wasn't hoping that somehow, magically, mysteriously, in the middle of the night, he would become a better disciple of Christ. He was actively committed to becoming all that Christ died to make him. He was personally resolved. And I love the song that we sang today, Brother Fred. I am resolved. He was personally resolved to make Psalm 27:8 a reality in his own life. Psalm 27:8 says, when thou saidest unto me, seek my face, my soul said to thee, thy face I will seek. Well, that's what Paul was saying. I am resolved that I'm going to get out of this of any kind of no man's land of emotional indifference. I'm going to push myself after the Lord. I press. No third party can do this for you. Notice Paul said, I press. I like this passage because this is not a man telling others what they ought to do. This is a man saying, this is what I intend to do. And I'll tell you in the final analysis, I can't do anything for you, and you can't do anything for me. The only one who can address this issue in my life is me. I have to be willing to say, I press. Psalmist said, my soul followeth hard after thee, O. I love the Ezra model of ministry. The Bible says Ezra was determined to seek the law of the Lord and to do it and to teach statutes in Israel. Now, in much of modern ministry, we get this thing upside down and backwards. We study in order to get messages so we can tell other folk what the Bible said. But Ezra said, I want to seek the law of the Lord, first of all, so I can do it myself. Paul said, I press. There's no such thing as secondhand religion. There's no such thing as hand-me-down spirituality. This is something every individual believer must do for himself. And I quoted last night that verse that is a favorite of my sons and of mine. Open thy mouth wide and I will fill it. And you mustn't miss the pronoun. Open thy mouth. Singular. It's not something we can do as a group. It's something we have to do one by one. Individually. In contrast to the lazy indifference of so many professing Christians, the man of our text was white hot in his intensity for the Lord. Rather than dozing off and drifting along and meandering through his Christianity, he could say, I keep pursuing. That's one way you could translate this verb, I press. Newer translations say, I keep pursuing. which brings up the fact that this is a present tense verb, which means this is not something that he did one time back there and then checked it off his to-do list and moved on to other things. This was the daily priority of his life. He made an everyday decision to keep pressing on in the Lord. Every day of his life. Reminds me of what Jesus said in Luke 9:23. If you're going to be my disciple, he said, you're going to have to deny yourself and take up your cross daily and follow me. Every day. You know the verse, we quote it all the time in church. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This day is a divine opportunity for me to say, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high call. God deliver us from the awful curse of occasional spirituality. God deliver us from the dread curse of getting fired up at camp meeting and revival time and the rest of the time drifting along. Occasional religion that only seeks God when the right buttons are pushed or the right mood is set. Aren't you sick to the high heavens of the mood kind of religion we have today? We have to get a certain mood set for us. People say, I can't worship under that music. I can't worship with that kind of setting. Friend, if it takes a certain mood or a certain setting to get you to worship, you're not worshiping anyway. You're just enjoying a little sanctified entertainment. Worship doesn't demand a certain mood. Worship doesn't require that the circumstances be all right and everything be just so. Paul said, I press. That's an everyday, moment-by-moment decision on his part. Not occasionally, not once in a while, not just when things get serious, not just when disaster looms. Day by day, I press. Paul was able to say at the end of his life, I finished my course. You know how you finish your course? By putting one foot in front of the other, step by step. You can't, everybody wants to get to the end of the way and say, I finished my course. But in order to finish the course, I have to take step by step what I'm told to do. Moment by moment, day by day. I press. I call that determined activity. It must be my daily determination to push myself forward in my relationship with the Lord. Secondly, a divine aim. Notice Paul said, I press toward the mark. That's the second clause. I press toward the mark. This child of God knew the direction that he ought to be moving, and he was pressing toward something very specific. He had a mark that he was aimed at. A definite aim. We began to travel 30 years ago. This is my 30th year. Just this month is my anniversary, my 30th anniversary of surrendering to full-time revival work, Bible conference, traveling ministry. All those years ago, no such thing as GPS. You know, I mean, everywhere I went by map. I have found some of the most unbelievably out-of-the-way places with a road map. I prided myself in the ability to find, to navigate myself to wherever I needed to go. And then GPSs came along, and frankly, I made fun of folks who'd use them. And then I was in the Philippines preaching some pastors' conferences one year, and my wife and son took another preacher's wife and children to San Antonio, which is from where I live, about 5 hours west of where I am in southeast Texas. They took them there for a few days at Six Flags in San Antonio while I was out of the country. We had certain times of the day, you know, it was a 13-hour time lag, just a few moments where we could talk each day by phone. And so she told me one day, she said, well, I've ordered a GPS. It'll be here by the time you get home. And I laughed. I said, what in the world? Why do you need, we've spent our life living by, why do you get, she said, well, when we left Six Flags, when we left the motel the next morning going home, she said, I was 40 miles toward California before I realized I was headed the wrong way. She said, I'm making real good time. And I thought, my, what a picture of many a Christian. We're making real good time. We're cutting up the, I'm telling you, son, we're kicking the dust up. But we have no cotton-picking idea which way we ought to be going. We're running ourselves ragged this way and that way, zigzagging through life. Paul said, I'm not confused about, I've got a mark. And I'm pressing toward that mark. I'm clear in my goal. There was a single-mindedness about the man of God. a clear focus in his ambitions and his intentions. He wasn't distracted by the momentary and the material world around him. He wasn't unsettled. He wasn't at all unsure concerning what his goal in life was to be. Back in verse 13, you find the certainty of it. I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. He had a clear goal in front of him. The Bible says in the book of James two times that the great enemy of the soul is double-mindedness. When a man can't seem to finally settle, you know what would be the greatest help in some of our lives? If we could just once and for all settle what we're going to do with ourselves. Which direction we want to move. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 16, the apostle Paul said, "We look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. Because the things that are seen are only temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal." He was clear in his concentration. Psalm 25, verse 15, the man of God in the book of Psalms said, "Mine eyes are ever toward the Lord." A concentrated attention. The preposition in this verse, toward, I press toward the mark. The Greek preposition can also be translated, I press along the mark. Or I press according to the mark. That's a very legitimate way to translate it. And I found at least one scholar who believed that that's the real sense of this verse. That what Paul was saying was, I press along the mark. In other words, like the runner's lane that's marked out. I'm running along the marked out course of biblical Christianity. I like that picture. Wouldn't that be in keeping? Isn't that in keeping with the very image of this verse of a runner in a race? The track is clearly marked and the competitors have to stay in their assigned lane lest they're disqualified from the competition. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 5 seems to bear this out when the apostle Paul said, if a man takes part in a competition, he does not get the crown if he's not kept the rules. The King James says, unless he competes lawfully, he cannot hope to win the prize. And so this would be in keeping with what Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew when he said, the way to life is through a narrow gate and the road is straight. It's confined. You can't just run willy-nilly in any direction and get to the journey's end that you want to arrive. My wife and I have been talking a lot about this lately. I really believe the thing I'm seeing more than anything else in the modern church world is that most everybody wants the benefits that come from a holy life. They just don't want to be holy. Everybody wants the blessing that comes from really walking with God in personal surrender, but without the inconvenience of walking with God in personal surrender. They want somehow to get the consequence of godliness and still live the everyday life of self-rule. But if I'm going to get to the desired end, then I'm going to have to run on the marked out course. This teaches the child of God cannot live haphazardly. We must be concentrated. We cannot let the flesh dictate. We have to run the salvation race the way God has marked it out. And listen, friend, American religion may have changed her mind, but the Lord never has. The Bible says God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. And this is the will of God, even your sanctification. Well, Paul had a definite aim in front of him. And then he had a delightful anticipation before him. He said, I press toward the mark for the prize. This believer knew full well that there is a prize to be won and he intended to win it. The prize speaks here of the award given to the game in the games to the victor. It can be translated with the word award or reward, legitimately either way. It's the same concept in 1 Corinthians 9:24, when the apostle Paul said, you know that in a race all compete, but only one gets the prize. So run that ye may obtain. So run that ye may obtain. Now there are some Bible teachers and preachers who try to shame you or even giving a thought to any kind of prize when you get into the presence of the Lord. They say, and I've heard and read them, shame on anyone who cares for receiving any kind of reward at the judgment seat of Christ. You ought to care only about pleasing him without any regard for receiving any prize other than his approval when you stand before him. To which I say, amen, absolutely. None of us ought to live for Jesus for what's in it for us. The Lord must never be merely a means to an end. Blessings now and rewards hereafter. He must never be a means to an end. He must be the end, such that we would seek and serve him if we never received a thing in return. I agree with that theoretically, but the Bible says again and again and again that there is reward and there are prizes, and we ought to want to get everything that we can when we stand before him, not for our sake, but so that we can have some crown to put back at the feet of the one who loved us so severely, so radically. John said it in 2 John verse 8. He said, keep those things which we've wrought. Don't lose the things that have been wrought so that you can receive a full reward. A full reward. Revelation 3:21. Jesus said, to him that overcometh, I'll grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. The Bible speaks again and again of crowns and rewards and prizes for the faithful servants of God. And it's not wrong to remind ourselves every once in a while that if we'll stay right and stay clean and live for the glory of God, there will be a payday someday. God doesn't pay every Friday, as R.G. Lee used to say, but he pays on time. Amen. There are consequences for the life you live as a child of God. Wonderful beyond compare for faithful surrender and obedience, and dreadful beyond anticipation for worldly compromise and spiritual indifference. 1 John 2:28 is in the Bible. It says, now little children, Christians, you see, now little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Paul doesn't specify in this text what the prize consists of, but some things need to be made clear concerning what he's not talking about. The prize is not salvation itself. The prize is not arrival in heaven, because those things are never spoken of in Scripture as prizes that have to be won. They're spoken of as gifts given by the grace of God and received simply by faith. The gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. By grace are you saved through faith. That not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. This is not about earning heaven. This is not about deserving salvation. But this is a man who knows he's saved, knows he's heaven bound, saying, on that day when I see Jesus face to face, I want to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. You love this old gospel song? Little is much if God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a prize, and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. Paul was motivated by a delightful anticipation that there was a prize that could be his when he sees Jesus at last. And you and I ought to live with that in mind as well. Let me show you this fourth thing. A decreed ambition, I call this. He said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The idea of calling runs throughout the Bible, resting on the reality that our God is a speaking God who calls and invites men to himself. The word calling in this text literally means an invitation. The root word means to speak out loud or to verbalize an invitation. The great God Jehovah is ever speaking, dealing with men's hearts, making himself known to us in ways that we really can't explain to someone else, but we know how real that voice of God is in. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. You see, that's the necessary foundation for being able to quote the much-loved Psalm 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I can't quote that unless I can also say, I'm his sheep. And I recognize that I'm his sheep because I hear his voice. And we have a relationship together. And I follow him. No, the text verse says, I strive toward the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. That's the new English translation. I strive toward the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul had heard the voice of God calling him to set his sights on something higher than the immediate, something better than the physical world around him. And he wrote of it in other places. Colossians 3, he said, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. That seems to put the lie to the old wise saying, you can be so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. No, that's not what makes us no earthly good. It's not that we think about heaven too much and think about spiritual things too much. What makes us no earthly good is that all we do is think about earth. The more absorbed I am in the earth, the less good I am to God while I'm walking topside of this planet. My friend, the Lord has a high calling. Paul said, the high calling of God. It's an upward call. It's a call to focus on spiritual and eternal realities. And then a divine availability. The verse says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Now this is the cornerstone and the capstone and everything in between of the work of God in our life. The choir sang it tonight, all those things attributed to him. We call him this, we call him that, holy, awesome. We call him healer, we call him provider. We call all the, and then that verse that got me. You've been all that to me, all that. And I thought all that and a thousand things more that I couldn't begin to enumerate. And you see, that's not theory to me. He's been that to me. He's been that to me. I think my wife says you think too much about songs sometimes, especially newer songs. And I get over analytical. I know I do. But the song we opened up with tonight, Days of Elijah, I used to have a problem with that. I said, what in the world? Who wrote that song? Days of Elijah, days of Moses, days of David, days, whose days is it anyway? Let's settle on something. Have you ever thought about that as you sung that song? And then as I got to thinking about it more, pressing a little further, I thought, well, heavenly days, of course, the Lord is all of this and a thousand things more than that. It may be the days of Elijah in my life and the days of David in your life at the same time in this sermon. He's all this and a And more than words can express and explain, Christ is the author and the finisher of our faith, and he's everything in between. Colossians chapter 3 verse 11 says, there's neither Greek nor Jew, there's neither circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Christ is all. God's upward call is mine tonight. Only because I'm in Christ Jesus. His shed blood bought my forgiveness. His victory over death has endowed me with eternal life. His high priestly intercession is what keeps me saved. His indwelling spirit is what empowers me to follow on to know the Lord. Romans chapter 8 says that this is God's high purpose. One translation renders my text like this, I go forward, I push forward to the mark, even the reward of the high purpose of God in Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 8 says, for we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, them he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son. That's the high purpose of God in Christ Jesus. That's what God's doing in my life, and every circumstance that I encounter through my earthly journey is working toward that great end. And Paul said, I know that's going on theoretically, theologically, providentially. I know here's God behind the scenes doing all this, but I'm saying this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to cooperate in every conscious way I can. I'm going to press toward that mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Because you see, and verse 8 emphasizes this, Paul said, in verse 8 of this very chapter, he said, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him. You see, Paul wasn't just something, Jesus wasn't just something to Paul, Jesus was everything to Paul, everything. And God help me, I can have that identical spirit in me tonight. I don't have to fiddle around, fool around with some halfway limp wrist excuse for Christianity. I don't have to live like that. What a grand verse this is in the Bible. I'm so glad this is in my Bible. This is a flesh and blood man, a human being, just as human as I am and you are, and yet he was able to live this quality of life. Not because of himself. He had nothing inherent within him that made him different from you. He was just a man who was determined to avail himself of all that Christ Jesus could be in him. It entices me. It delights me. It draws me out of myself and my own petty agendas. It stirs me to get off my spiritual backside and start living out the passion of Psalm 42. As the deer panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. I don't suppose I could conclude. I found out tonight what I already suspected, that Brother Michael is another one of these all-around cowboys. I've been hearing him sing on the pew. I knew he had a good singing voice, and then he gets up here and sings for me. These singing preachers, bless God, they make you just want to take a dip of snuff, don't they? They got all these talents, these five talent men, you know. Brother Jerry, I just have to croak along, and they sing so beautifully. If I could sing like Brother Michael, I'd sing this for you, but I'm just going to quote it to you. It was written in 1898. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining. Day by day, still praying as I onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. And then this is what I like. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled, for faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. There's a higher place to live, ladies and gentlemen. We don't have to live in this mud hole world with our focus only on what's happening at the moment. There's a celestial city in front of me. There's a golden city on the horizon. Stand with me, please. We'll have a word of prayer. I should have alerted Brother Dennis last night. We haven't been together in a long time. I'm abrupt. When I finish preaching, I just shut her down. I'm abrupt. I thrust it on him last night. The altar's open. You've already had the opportunity to go to the altar, but if the Lord speaks to your heart, you just feel free. Just do anything the Holy Ghost tells you to do. Father, now in Jesus' name, help us to take your text, your Bible, right into our souls and allow the Holy Ghost to embroidery into us this passion that will define us as it did Paul every day of our life, so that when the last day comes and our final breath is drawn, we can look back with a sigh of satisfaction and say, I've finished my course. God, help us, Jesus.